Hi there, I'm Nile Bowie coming to you for Global Research TV on this Monday, July 2nd, 2012. The nation of Pakistan faces turmoil. With terrorist insurgency in its tribal areas, a relentless U.S. drone strike campaign, and a separatist movement in the province of Balochistan, many analysts question how Pakistan will face its current challenges.
U.S. President Barack Obama, meanwhile, has admitted for the first time that drones are regularly striking Taliban and Al-Qaeda targets in Pakistan's tribal areas. The unmanned aircraft have been blamed for killing civilians as well as Taliban fighters.
This is a targeted, focused effort at people who are on a list of active terrorists who are trying to go in and harm Americans, hit American facilities, American bases, and so on.
In our view, drones are not only completely illegal and unlawful and have no authorization to be used within the domains of international law, but even more importantly, they are counterproductive to your objective of getting this region rid of militancy and terrorism and extremism. Because if one strike leads to getting you target number one or target number three today, you're creating five more targets or 10 more targets in the militancy that it breeds, in the fodder that it gives to the militants to attract more people to join their ranks.
The drone strikes, suicide bombings, and the ongoing conflict in the region has made all of us mentally ill. Even our women and children are traumatized and experiencing acute stress.
In the last 6 years, there's been hundreds of U.S. drone strikes in the tribal areas. That does not include other attacks by manned aircraft. Over 3,000 people have been killed and many more wounded. But no one knows the true extent of the psychological impact of a 10-year conflict.
Punjabi tasallut se chutkara hasil karna aur Baloch qoum ke liye ek khushhal zindagi hai jisme aman, insaaf aur barabari ho. Hum uske liye jadoojahd.
Dehshat gardi nahi balki aman aur tahaffuz hoga.
ہو سکتا ہے اگر وہ کل کھلا کو بہت زیادہ بمباری کرے گا ہمارے عام لوگوں پہ جو پہلے بھی کیا اس نے شاید اس وقت تک ہم صبر سے کام کر ہو سکتا ہے کہ ہمارا ٹارگٹ اسلام آباد بھی ہو ہمارا ٹارگٹ لاہور بھی ہو ہمارا ٹارگٹ پھنڈی بھی ہو اس میں تو کوئی شک نہیں
دی ارائیول آف امریکا ونس اگین انڈین کیم رائڈنگ آن دیئر بیک سو دے آر ٹیکنگ ایکچولی واٹ از کالڈ a free ride on the American shoulders, and they came into Afghanistan and they started spreading their tentacles, and they are up to their old games. So behind this entire turmoil that one sees in Balochistan,
well, there was a thinking in the United States that they wanted to separate Balochistan from Pakistan so that in case Pakistan does not play the game with them, they could make use of the Balochistan territory as a separate independent state. And this was also the purpose of the Indians. So Indians and the Americans, they did collaborate.
For more on these issues, I've spoken to Eric Draitser, editor of StopImperialism.com. Eric, thank you for being with me today. Now, Defense Secretary Leon Panetta has recently acknowledged the fact that the U.S. is waging war in the tribal regions of northwestern Pakistan. Panetta has also said that the U.S. is losing patience with Islamabad and that Pakistan should do more to combat terrorist entities such as the Haqqani Network. Now, although the CIA claims to claims that the drone strikes in Pakistan haven't produced a single civilian casualty, which we know to be pretty fictitious, studies done by the Bureau of Investigative Journalism found that since 2004, up to 780 civilians have been killed out of a total of 2,600 casualties, including 160 children. So, Eric, what I'm trying to ask you is, what has motivated the government of Pakistan to permit these drone strikes on their territory?
Well, I mean, that's obviously a complicated question. I think there's a variety of motivations here. Number one, it's important to understand that to a large extent, the Pakistani government has no choice. They need cooperation with the United States. If we remember going all the way back to the immediate aftermath of 9/11, there was the not so, you know, overt threat from the Bush administration that Pakistan must be a partner in the war on terror lest they be bombed into the Stone Age. And it's, you know, we've seen over the last decade or so, Pakistan has been probably one of the most vociferous allies of the United States in the war on terror. So there's that aspect of it. There's another aspect of it that I think is underplayed in the Western media, and that is the overall weakness of the Pakistani government. The Zardari Gilani government, the ruling PPP party, they don't enjoy a tremendous amount of support in terms of their foreign relations inside of Pakistan. A lot of the people inside Pakistan see the government as weak, as inept, as incompetent, as entirely corrupt from within. So there's that aspect of it as well. And I think that there's also a very obvious point to be made, and that is, what choice do they really have? The reality is the Pakistani government is in no position to stand up against the United States. Sure, they have the backing of the Chinese and perhaps tacitly the Russians as well, but even so, that's not to say that they're ready to have any face-to-face confrontation with the United States over the issue of drones. Furthermore, of course, Pakistan does have their own interests in the drone program. They have seen a rise in terrorism emanating out of the Waziristan region. They would like to possibly use the United States as a way of attacking those militants without having to send in their own military. So it's a precarious position that the Pakistani government finds themselves in. That being said, though, they don't approve of the drone strikes. They, in fact, have outwardly stated that the drone strikes are probably the biggest example of what is inflaming the people inside of Pakistan. So when you want to analyze the role or the attitude of the Pakistani government, you have to see it both from an internal political perspective and from an external one. Remember also, the Pakistani government is kind of divided into two factions, essentially. You have a civilian government, which is the Zardari Gilani faction, and then you have the military faction as well, which is not indirectly led by General Kayani. And the Kayani military faction is always traditionally close to the Chinese, whereas the civilian faction, as the counterweight, is much closer to the United States. So I think that there's multiple dynamics, overlapping dynamics, that really kind of play into this idea of the drone strikes and U.S. relations.
Excellent. Okay, cool. Well, it's not really surprising that Islamabad and Washington's relations are at an all-time low at the moment, considering the volume of drone attacks that since the strikes in November, which killed 24 Pakistani soldiers. Now, that prompted Islamabad to cut the U.S.-NATO supply routes, which are running through the territory into Afghanistan. Now, Central Asian supply routes are available to the U.S. and NATO, although operating them would be very costly in comparison to the route in Pakistan. So how do you see the situation playing out?
Well, there's a couple of issues at play. Number one, of course, the Pakistani government has already made the overt demand that they want a fee per NATO truck going into Afghanistan, something like a couple of $1,000s per truck, which, of course, the United States could very easily pay. It's a very minimal fee in the context of how much we're actually spending on this war in Afghanistan. However, the Pakistanis are also, and this is coming from internal pressure primarily, they're demanding an apology from the United States, a formal apology from the Obama administration, something they will never get in an election year. I mean, to me, there's a 0% chance that you'll see the Obama administration apologizing to the Pakistanis, even though they know that they are at fault, that they, you know, committed this, what can we call it? I mean, some, I guess, would say a mistake, or some would say an atrocity against the Pakistani military. That's one of the dynamics as well. So the Pakistanis, the government at least, is trying to play to their own people, to their own base, saying, yes, we're demanding an apology from the United States, et cetera, et cetera. The reality is they'll never get it. The question is whether they're actually going to settle for these fees or whether this is going to continue as a major conflict. We've also seen, at the same time that this conflict has gone on, the U.S. Congress becoming more rapidly anti-Pakistan, in particular in regards to the Balochistan question, as led by Rohrabacher, which I'm sure we'll get into in a minute, but also the fact that the U.S. Congress has now blatantly stated that the Pakistani government, that Pakistan itself is a failed state. Now, to call a country a failed state is to essentially say that you're no longer equal partners diplomatically. Now, that's very important because naturally then the Pakistanis are going to turn to what they've always called to be their all-weather friend, the Chinese. So it's almost as if we could say that the question of the supply routes really is a microcosm of a much larger issue, and that is whether the Pakistanis are going to be able to repair their diplomatic relationship with the United States, or if this damage was irreparable and we're moving into a new phase for Pakistan in terms of their diplomatic relations.
Excellent. All right, let's get into Balochistan for a second. So the state of Balochistan, it encompasses western Pakistan, eastern Iran, areas of southern Afghanistan, and its ports are of crucial importance to Chinese shipping activities in the Indian Ocean and various parts of the world, making it a region of high strategic importance. Now, can you expand on how external forces who have operated in the region are utilizing this campaign of Baloch separatism in an effort to destabilize the region?
Well, again, there's a variety of issues. As we see all throughout the issue of Pakistan, there are overlapping interests that are constantly at play. So on the one hand, we have the Baloch separatist groups or the terrorist groups or whichever other groups are operating in that region. Many of them, and I don't want to say all of them because there's so many different ones, but many of them have direct ties to Western intelligence. For example, we know for certain Jundallah, as we saw in Foreign Policy Magazine's expose of Jundallah being infiltrated and controlled by both the Israeli Mossad and the CIA. We know that the Baloch Liberation Army and Brahamdag Bukti and the Bukti family, they have ties going way back to British MI6. We also know that the CIA, in particular in the last, I would say, 3 or 4 years, really since Petraeus has become the significant player, the CIA has become more and more involved in the destabilization of Balochistan. We had a report in March of 2011 from the peninsula of Qatar, which was then repeated by many other publications and quoted, that the Petraeus people had actually created a program where they were giving $500 monthly payments to agents, essentially creating a network of agents throughout Balochistan. Now, the question is what role they're playing. I mean, some of these agents I could imagine are simply informants giving information, while others, perhaps terrorists, perhaps, you know, it's a question mark. But the point is the presence and the economic influence that the United States intelligence agencies have in that region, as you can imagine. I mean, a $500 monthly payment to someone who's living on very little per day, I mean, this is a significant amount of money. So there's a major investment going into the region for the purposes of destabilizing it. Now, at the same time, we're also seeing these terrorist organizations, and one I didn't mention, Lashkar-e-Taiba, which has been operating in that region also for years. This is part of a much broader campaign. It is not simply the destabilization of Balochistan. That would be only one, I would say that would be the microcosm of it. I think the larger context is a destabilization of both Pakistan and Iran simultaneously. Where Balochistan straddles that border, one can imagine Jundallah launching their terrorist attacks into Iran, Baloch Liberation Army into Pakistan, and in fact spreading it from there. And that's precisely what we've seen. When I first started covering the issue of Balochistan, it was really kind of focused in Balochistan. Maybe once or twice we saw something happen in the capital of the region, which is Quetta. But now in recent weeks and months, we've seen it moving into Lahore, into Karachi, into some of the major cities of Pakistan. In other words, bringing the Balochistan conflict to the streets of Pakistan and creating in the minds of the population of the country a sense of unease, a sense that they're under attack, and that they're going to now push the government to create some sort of a resolution with the Baloch people. And that's precisely what we're seeing. The issue becomes, how are they going to do it? Are they going to be forced to the negotiation table, or is this going to be something that's going to be done on a development basis? One thing that I've argued, that many others have argued as well, is that because Balochistan has been so severely underdeveloped and so, I guess we could say, stripped of its wealth, that they are, how can we say, they are seen as backwards by the rest of Pakistan. And so when the government comes in with investment in education, in infrastructure, in healthcare, and these types of things, you see the situation in Balochistan improving. Unfortunately, we recently had public comments from people like Braham Dag Bukti, who says that this situation is too far gone. In other words, no negotiation with the Pakistani government, further destabilization of the country in the hopes of framing this as if Pakistan is occupying Balochistan. That is the rhetoric coming out of these, I guess we could call them the terrorists or separatists or whatever you want to say. That is the rhetoric, and that is very instructive because essentially that is the declaration of civil war, and that becomes tremendously dangerous for the entire region.
Sure. I remember reading just yesterday, Jilani, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, he basically made a statement saying how, just as you said, that the need for increased, you know, recognition of the Baluch region and things along that level. Now, can you just talk briefly about the port of Gwadar and the strategic significance around there?
Yeah, I was going to mention Gwadar. Gwadar is very important for people to know because this is not just infrastructure development of Balochistan. This represents one of the largest investments anywhere in the world for the Chinese. The Chinese invested in the creation of this Gwadar port on the coast of Pakistan, which is essentially a foothold that the Chinese have into the Indian Ocean and more broadly towards their resource-rich partners in Africa. So the Gwadar port is really the point at which Chinese imports hit the Asian landmass. So because of that, it's of course naturally strategically significant for the Chinese. And at the same time, for the Baloch people, this is of course the main source of income for them. You know, we want to remember that many of these peoples in that region, they still live a very nomadic lifestyle. Many of them, you know, don't have access to a telephone or to roads or whatever. So when we think about Gwadar, we think about the future of Balochistan. And so the Chinese, naturally, they want to control this. This is part of a much broader strategy for the Chinese. And the government in Islamabad understands this and understands the significance of their relations with China. And so we've seen in recent weeks move towards funding more infrastructure development around Gwadar Sea. One of the sad truths of Pakistan is even when a great idea becomes an on-the-ground tangible project, it doesn't immediately become successful because what you need is more than just a port. You need to have road connectivity. You need to have rail connectivity. These are all things that have to be built from scratch. And because of the destabilization of Balochistan, this becomes more and more and more difficult, precisely the same problem we're seeing with the development of pipelines through Balochistan as well. The need to develop the infrastructure is there, and it's difficult to find investors in a region that looks like it's on the brink of civil war.
Exactly right. I just want to ask you briefly about the Wahhabi terrorist group, Sepa Sahabe, which has been implicated in the persecution of Pakistani Shia Muslims. In 2012, April alone, more than 250 Shias were targeted and killed, and the group reportedly receives backing from Saudi Arabia and Bahrain. Now, we see members of the GCC in other parts of the world, you know, arming Syrian rebels, who have similarly targeted Alawites, Shias in Hula and elsewhere. So what interest do the Persian Gulf monarchies have in Pakistan?
Well, again, I mean, that's multifaceted. I think that it's interesting to note because Saudi Arabia and Pakistan have certain ties, and they are, you know, they do have a strategic relationship. At the same time, the targeted killing of the various Shia groups, and in particular the Hazara minority of the Shia. This is very significant because this is, again, fomenting internal conflict. The Shia minority inside of Pakistan has for decades felt persecuted. They've sort of tried to go under the radar, and in recent weeks and months, we've seen this ratcheting up of these targeted killings. This has multiple purposes, of course. Number one is that this is targeted at the Iranians. The Iranians, the most powerful Shiite country, you know, in the world, the Iranians look at what's happening in Pakistan, and they understand that they're also the victims of a covert war against their country. And they see the same thing happening in Pakistan. It's a provocation, naturally. It's also an attempt to divide the Pakistani people against each other. And I would just add to that, that we don't only want to focus on the killing of these Shiite groups, because we also see the movement of these various radicals from the Pashtun areas and from the Waziri areas who are coming into main, I guess we could call it Pakistan proper, if you will, and targeting various other groups. So it's, again, the fomenting of sectarian conflict in a nation which has traditionally been very strong in terms of its continuity and territorial integrity because of the, you know, the military governments that they've had over the course of a few decades. So there's that aspect of it. At the same time, what do the Gulf countries have at stake here? Well, there's a few things. Number one is the United States. The United States controls Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Bahrain, these various GCC countries. I mean, maybe it's going a little too far to call them total proxy states, but they're certainly clients. And these client states, they're essentially executing the agenda of the United States that the U.S. government is not able to do. The U.S. is engaged in these drone attacks, in the destabilization, more covert type things, but they don't have the direct terrorist connections that they have in Saudi Arabia, that they have in Qatar, which, as you pointed out, we see it playing out in Syria, we saw it playing out in Libya, all over the world. So it is utilizing the terrorist networks of the Gulf monarchies in order to destabilize a country which, as I've already mentioned, is strategically necessary for the Chinese. All of this needs to be seen in the broad context of a proxy war against China. It is to prevent the Chinese from consolidating dominance of South Asia. Because if the Chinese can consolidate that dominance, the U.S. is totally cut out, and that will then threaten not just their interest in the Middle East, but U.S. hegemony worldwide.
Excellent. Now, you just touched briefly before, you had mentioned that you wanted to touch on the TAPI and some of the other mm-hmm. pipeline construction projects. Can you touch on that?
Sure. Well, there's many different pipeline projects at stake. So specific to Balochistan, we have the Iran-Pakistan pipeline. This is the one that the United States cannot accept and will do anything to try to subvert. As you can imagine, an Iran-Pakistan pipeline could very easily become an Iran-Pakistan-China pipeline, which at that point would really be, as I just mentioned, the consolidation of power for the Chinese in the region, and also a way for the Iranians to sort of maybe consolidate their own position against the attacks of the United States. So the Iran-Pakistan pipeline, which has really been proposed now for decades, is only coming to fruition in the last couple of years. And the issue has been and continues to be, who is going to invest in this and who is going to build it? The Iranians have already built their end of the pipeline. Mm-hmm. So it's really up to what's happening in Pakistan. The problem, as I've mentioned, is number one, the destabilization of Balochistan, making it difficult, if not impossible, to guarantee any developer from, you know, the Germans have bid on it, the Italians have bid on it, many other nations have bid on this project. How do you guarantee to them that their contractors and that their investment is safe? It's impossible to do if Balochistan slides into a civil war. At the same time, we also see the Iranians recently in the last couple of weeks, they've actually made public statements saying they're willing to fund the entire project. Not only their side, but even the Pakistani side. So in other words, Pakistan gets a pipeline for free. As long as they can create the conditions necessary for this development. So the Iran-Pakistan pipeline is essential. Remember, too, that most people in the West don't understand this. And I, talking to my contacts in Pakistan, they make it ever more clear to me how big this crisis of energy is in Pakistan. They are running a vast shortage of electrical power and various other energy sources. How are they going to get their power? How are the people of Pakistan and Karachi and Lahore and Islamabad, how are they going to live at the, you know, at the standard of living of Western nations if they have to deal with these rolling blackouts, these brownouts, this load shedding, and all of these other policies that they put in place because of an energy deficiency? Well, they cannot. So the answer is you have to have energy infrastructure. So Pakistan, even in the face of overt U.S. threats, continues to work with the Iranians to build this pipeline. So the United States actually is supporting a different project, a project called the TAPI, the T-A-P-I. This is Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India. So this is a north-south pipeline originating in the Caspian region of Turkmenistan. Remember, Turkmenistan has vast resources of natural gas wealth, and they're only now beginning to really get into the exporting game. So Turkmenistan is looking to sell their energy and really to become kind of the, I guess we could call it the energy breadbasket of South Asia. So the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India is a way of bringing Caspian energy down into Pakistan and into the Indian subcontinent. Tremendously significant for the region. You want to have large-scale economic development. You want to create a situation where Pakistan and India have grown closer together. Well, all of this is going to be built around economic development. Mutually beneficial economic development. Precisely what the TAPI is. So then one would logically ask the question, well, why would the United States be supporting this if it leads to independent economic growth? Well, the United States doesn't really have a choice. They have to choose between, I think, from my perspective, two disagreeable options. But to them, they are far more content with seeing a TAPI pipeline develop than an Iran-Pakistan pipeline develop, because that would completely undermine the war against Iran, the sanctions regime, the covert attacks on Iran, and all of it. So there is, and I'm just giving a very cursory analysis, there's many other projects that are involved in all of this, and one other one that I would point out is the East-West pipeline, or rather, sorry, the West-East pipeline. This is running from Turkmenistan into China. So China kind of plays this background role in all of this, really kind of involved in these dealings in an indirect way, and the United States, on the other hand, also plays a background role, kind of pushing it in the direction that they want. So again, the pipeline question, I think, is another example of this, what could we call it, an indirect or a tangential proxy war between the United States and China.
Very interesting stuff. Now, President Zardari has recently called for Pakistan's full membership into the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So if that were to, you know, take place, what would Islamabad be able to bring to the table as part of the SCO?
Well, it's an interesting question, because one would think, well, the Pakistanis aren't really that well economically developed. They don't really bring that that much to the table. But in fact, what they bring to the table, well, a couple of things. Number one, and I think this is the most important in the short term for both China and Russia, because both of those countries really obviously dominate the SCO. Pakistanis bring counterterrorism expertise to the table. The Pakistanis have been involved in counterterrorism operations now, even before 9/11, really going back at least a few decades. So counterterrorism is a major aspect of what the SCO was all about. The Chinese are facing a threat from the ETIM. This is the East Turkestan Islamic Movement, also known as the Chinese Taliban. Okay, they are centered in these border regions of Pakistan, just as the other extremists are. And they are launching attacks against the Chinese, attempting to destabilize the Chinese. At the same time, the Chinese are also being threatened by the Uyghur resistance movement, or the separatist movement, I guess we should say. And the Uyghur movement, which has direct links to the National Endowment for Democracy and the State Department through Rabia Kadir, the leader, the Uyghur movement also is part of a destabilization campaign. So at the same time, the Chinese have multiple fronts in which they need to expertise in counterterrorism. This is what the Pakistanis offer. The Pakistanis also offer, and this is, of course, naturally the most important one of all, and that is land-based access for the Chinese to their imports coming from Africa. The Chinese are tremendously hampered by the fact that they have to go through the South China Sea and the Straits of Malacca just to get to the Indian Ocean from which they can go to Africa. If they have the port of Gwadar, and in addition to that, a pipeline connecting Gwadar into mainland China, well, then naturally Pakistan becomes the corridor, the conduit for all of this energy either coming from Iran or coming from the Caspian region or the imports coming from Africa to the port of Gwadar. So there's a number of different ways we could almost view Pakistan as an intersection for the Chinese. Now, on the Russian side of this, the Russians have traditionally been absent, or mostly absent, I guess we could say, in Pakistan, but not so much recently. We've seen, and this is an important project for people to know, the CASA 1000 project. The CASA 1000 is a Russian-sponsored project that is going to bring electrical power from the former Soviet republics of Central Asia down into Pakistan. Now, as I mentioned already, the tremendous shortage of energy severely hampers any political attempts of the Zardari Gilani government or any other government, for that matter, in Pakistan. How are you going to legitimize yourself in the eyes of the people if you can't even provide power? So the CASA 1000 is very, very significant as well. So there's an economic angle to what the Pakistanis bring. There's this logistical counterterrorism angle that they also bring. And then, of course, this is all to be seen as a play against the United States to pull Pakistan out of the orbit of the United States and bring them into the orbit of Russia and China. And then the last point I would also mention is that as Pakistan looks for entry into the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, so too does India look for the same membership. So what we see is both countries, traditional enemies, going into the same organization, and that is why we're seeing a warming of relations between Pakistan and India. So in that way, the SCO becomes a platform for this international conflict resolution, and also a platform for regional economic development that would be beneficial, really, for world peace.
Great. That moves on to, brings up the next question here. Now, as we've talked about throughout the interview here, Pakistan suffers from great levels of poverty. It's received harsh criticism for its inability to deal with internal fundamental groups and also various natural disasters. We saw the floods last year, very tragic. And as you mentioned, the term failed state has been associated with Pakistan. So what changes can Islamabad make to improve conditions on the economic front and to provide security to its people in the coming years, do you think?
Well, I think that part of it they're already doing, and that is looking for these development projects. Sure. You're not going to be able to provide, relief aid or any of these other things if you don't have roads, if you don't have rails, if you don't have the necessary infrastructure. That's what Pakistan is severely lacking. Also, it's difficult to invest in things like education when you have villages remote that are removed from Islamabad and on the peripheries of the country, completely isolated. So in that way, the idea is to create a situation where Pakistan becomes to be more cohesive whole rather than the Punjabi majority in the center of the country, with the outlying minorities kind of, again, seeing themselves as outsiders. So on the one hand, they need to consolidate control and sort of reestablish a sense of nationalism and pride in all of the different regions of Pakistan. This is something that Imran Khan, one of the powerful or rather popular politicians in Pakistan, has been advocating. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, of course, they need to have foreign investment. They're looking for foreign investment, and the question is, where is that going to come from? Traditionally, Pakistan has depended on U.S. aid, but recently we're seeing a little bit less of that, partially because of the economic depression, partially because of the breakdown in relations. There's a variety of other factors related to that. As we see Pakistan entering the SCO, it becomes more apparent that Chinese development, Russian economic development, and in fact, we're seeing some of the members of the European Union trying to get in on the development in Pakistan. So this is going, I think, in that direction. At the same time, though, these are how can we call it? These are entrenched problems. These are social, institutional crises in Pakistan, things that take generations to solve. So while you need to build roads and hospitals and schools, you also need to invest in those that are already there. So things like scholarships, right? Things like expanding access to public education, expanding access to healthcare, institutionalizing these economic rights that people in Pakistan want, because that is the only thing that is going to resist the breakup of the country. It's very important to remember, Pakistan is under attack. Pakistan is it's a country that kind of hangs by a thread, if you want to look at it that way. You have Baluch minority, Pashtun minority, you have all these different minority groups, and what's going to keep them together? It's a common destiny, a common economic future, and the only way that you're going to see that is with large-scale economic investment and large-scale development, precisely what the Chinese offer Pakistan, and that's precisely what the United States fails to offer.
Eric, that was point by point an excellent analysis of the situation in Pakistan right now. Thank you so much for joining me today. Have a good one, mate.
Absolutely. Thanks, Nile.
No problem. All right.